Geneva. Thank you for the introduction. I'm so happy to be here today and share my ideas and thoughts with such a wonderful young-looking and young-feeling and bright, smiling crowd. So, when I was given the topic for this month, survival, it was very interesting because the first thought came to mind, survival, why we should speak about survival. We live in a modern society where the survival is not really an issue we would think. We've got a roof, the shelter, we've got jobs, we've got education, we've got lots of gadgets. We don't really worry too much what we're going to eat every morning, unless you're on a very special diet. So, but actually, when you look a little bit deeper, you understand that survival is about our society, and this is more urgent actually for this part of the globe more than ever. And because the children and young generation is the most vulnerable part of our society, they of course affected the most. And I hope I can share you what I mean by that, but I also would like to make sure that I share my understanding of situation and my knowledge about it with you in order to bring your awareness and empower you to do something about it even further. It's so nice to know that you're thinking about healthy eating, but everybody's idea might be slightly different. So we try to unite those thoughts be more proactive if you want. So in this filter in your mind, I would like you to continue. So a couple years ago, maybe a little bit more, I came across this fantastic expression by Dr. David Katz, who is a quite well-known pediatrician in the US. And he said, this is maybe the first generation of children to have a shorter life expectancy than their parents. You know, when I read this, somehow I experienced the goosebumps. Because for a second, I just imagined that I'm going to live longer than my two beautiful children. And I think this is a nightmare for any parent. And then I thought, okay, but why is this going on? We're talking about, again, the health insurance, how wonderful life it is, about education, our children achieving lots of different goals in this life. Why this expression took the place in the beginning. And then I started to dig in into it, and this is actually how I switched my direction and started to work with the children with special needs, and especially children with autism. So let's see what's going on actually worldwide in terms of statistics. And I'm probably not going to read all of this, but just pointing out a few. 1 in 2 children have a chronic health condition worldwide. 1 in 6 has developmental delay. 1 in 5 children have a mental health condition, and so on and so on. In the US now, 1 in 48 children got autism. What is the most interesting, that Switzerland, this beautiful country, as we think, has one of the highest rates in the teenager suicide in Europe. So what the hell is going on, you would think. And I would like to use autism as an example, because this is the main way I'm working, the children I'm dealing with, but this is just an illustration, because what's going on with the mental disorders, this is also going on in the different areas as well. And just as a short example, for example, type 2 diabetes didn't exist in children at all a few years ago, and now it's growing with a 3.5 annual rate, okay? So, something going on. And just talking about autism, you probably don't know too much about it. And I did know about it as well. When I studied neuroscience back in Cambridge, it was mentioned in the textbooks, but not really much. Now, you probably come across it very, very often. So, what is that condition? Maybe you a little bit familiar, but you answer this question to yourself, and I just would like to demonstrate a little bit what the parents of children with autism experience on everyday basis, just for small illustration.
You can't really take a day off of autism. Autism never took a day off on me.
She always has to have my attention, and it's exhausting.
He doesn't speak much at all.
Hi. Hi.
He has never spoken a single word.
Everything about Daniel's life that seems normal for a typical kid, like going out to dinner or going to a park, all that for us is work.
Oh, good.
A little bit more. I'm almost done. Almost done.
I so hope I won't be changing diapers when he's 6 and a half.
I didn't choose to do this. I'm not a therapist. I was drafted. I have an autistic child.
This is just a small example of what children with autism may look like, but actually the spectrum is very big, and that's why we call it the whole spectrum spectrum disorder. The kids can be anything from low functional, where they don't speak, don't communicate properly, don't really orientate in the space very well, up to high functioning children, where they can be genius in certain areas, but also still not very well integrating in the society. And this is the main issue. These children not very well becoming part of our future society. They're very oversensitive to everything, and the parents really struggle and to provide them safety for their future. They're really afraid, how are they going to survive? Are they going to be hurt, abused, manipulated? So it is lots of issues there, but what we know for sure that autism is growing. And it is really, we experience real pandemic actually, and if you see the statistics based on a most advanced statistics come from US. So in 2000, we had 148 children was affected by spectrum. And in 2016, it was 150, now it's 148. And if this statistics is continuous like that, by 2060, every third child may be affected by autism. So it simply means if we don't do anything about this curve and we don't try to, you know, flat it a little bit, so every family in the future probably will be affected by this disorder only. And we're talking about more general health condition as well. So, and if you don't plan to have your families and children now because you're enjoying your life, you might start to think about in 5-10 years, and that's obviously the rate of having some issues with the children will grow. So just be aware of that, okay? This is the issues we have to understand, take it aboard and actually accept it. Yes, this is a challenge of our society, but there is so much we can do about it. And we're going to learn how we're going to deal with it and be proactive about it, okay? And we're talking about survival today, and that's why I thought actually survival can be brought up on at least on the three different levels here. We're talking about every child individually, we're talking about all of us as a future family, as a parents, as a grandparents, or you know, neighbors or friends and things like that. And of course, we're talking about the future of our whole society, because young generation, this is our future. So what is going on? Before we can be proactive about it and stay cool and know what to do, we need to understand why this is taking place. So we used to think that, and I'm not going to be very scientific, don't be afraid, the gene expression is playing a huge role. Genetic factor is very, very big in our life. And we always talking about that, oh, you know, there is genes on my mother's line, on my father's line, so if I'm a bit lazy, this is my grandma's playing in me, and things like that. So actually, the science nowadays allows to understand that other factors, environmental factors and lifestyle factors are playing absolutely enormous, enormous, huge role in what we are, in what we look like, and how we perform, how we feel, what we achieve in our life. And all these factors, they really interconnected tightly and influence each other very much. Just think about it. About 200 years ago, survival was a completely different concept. So we were struggling with the hygiene, we were looking for antibiotics to survive, we were looking for good food, for clean water, for shelter and things like that. Now everything is upside down. So these miracles, life-saving molecules like antibiotics and vaccines actually are playing very not very healthy role in the society right now, because they, due to overdose, the antibiotics messing around with our gut flora and causing developing of superbugs. Vaccinations actually the prime cause of heavy metals in contaminations and toxifications in our body, especially in children. So we live in the world where the medicine has become toxic, food has become nutritionally depleted and heavily contaminated, and toxins are by accumulating in the body and passing from generation to generation. And this is very important to understand, because the young generation, they've got completely different basal level of toxins in their body to compare with the generations before. They've got much more compromised stuff from the very beginning. But the fantastic science also give us lots of knowledge and understanding how our genetic material works. And what we know now, and this is very empowering, but also give us huge responsibility, that we've got a control of our own health. And that happens because we simply can switch on and switch off our genes. So that's really cool, and that's really happening. We've got power by controlling our environment and lifestyle. We've got power to control which genes will be expressed, which will be silent. And if you've got predisposition for certain condition, it doesn't mean you're going to have it, because you've got the power to control it. So stop blaming your genes. We call it epigenetics. Epi actually means on top of, above of genetics in this particular case. So if you've got your genetic information in DNA, so all different factors coming from around you actually playing the crucial role how this genetic information is translated to real life. And here you just see basically everything. We try to cover everything. This is all epigenetic factors around us. And you can see it's really, really broad. Everything from seasonal correlations through the chemicals and drugs and financial status, all the medical support you've got around, the social interaction, your physiological, psychological state, they all play a huge role. But what is interesting, combination of these factors together are strong player more than ever. And my favorite, of course, diet and microbiome. And I'm just going to focus for extra second on each of them. So, diet. It's not even a diet, rather than quality of food we're talking about it today. And what we have to admit, the food is not very good quality anymore. So during 60, 70 last years, the quality of food changed so much because the way it's grown, the way it's produced, that when you're going to supermarket, about 80% of food not designed for actually humans to be eaten. It's purely marketing exercise. And that's something you really have to remember. We need to search for good quality food. Just think about it. Pesticides, hormones, antibiotics, all present in our plant and animal food. GMO, trans fats, hydrogenated oils, all there. The way we prepare food is very important. If you put very good quality, what we think, food in a microwave, you're just killing everything, okay? If you barbecue, and this is a season promising for barbecue, be careful. All these black things on your barbecue food giving you lots of acrylamides and lots of other toxins which are cancerogenic. Artificial sweeteners, we think, oh yes, I'm reducing sugar, but I'm using sweeteners. Don't be fooled, they are really bad guys. All artificial dyes, all the preservatives, anything E, just be aware of that. Just get away from that. There is lots of symptoms they're causing, I'm not going to read. They're all the flavor enhancer, and again, the industry getting very clever because we used to have only MSG, and now it's a huge list of other things which very similar, but they call differently, then you can't easily recognize them, even you read labels. Plastic is very big problem because it's leaking, and all foods and all drinks and everything we find in plastic nowadays. So for this reason only, because they are endocrine disruptors, our children getting to the puberty approximately 10 years earlier than 200 years ago. This is really big issue. And even you think you eat healthy, and it's really nice to see that you think about it. So, and going vegetables, think about it. The vegetables grow on a depleted soil, and by the time we bring them back in our kitchen and put in our salad, how many days they've been sitting on the shelf, they really got huge reduction of nutrition in them. So all these factors, if you think, play huge role. And a little bit about microbiome. Microbiome, I call it from gum to bum. It's just easy to remember because it's really everywhere. And basically, it's a combination of all life microorganisms which living inside and outside of us, but especially we call it forgotten organ. It's about 2 kilograms material, life material inside of your gut. And this is exactly what it's called, the second brain. And two brains really interconnected between each other. And you probably got this feeling of butterflies in your tummy from time to time when you've got important interview or exam or fell in love or something, or I felt this morning before I started to talk to you. So this is the second brain talking to you, okay? This is real. There is so many neurons sitting there and manipulating the way we live and pushing and controlling our brain in our head. This microbiome playing such a huge role in many, many different systems, but just think about 80% of serotonin is made in the gut, 50% of dopamine is made in the gut, 70% of your immune system is actually placed in your gut. If there is something going wrong with the microbiome, you know, this is where the problem starts. And what is the cool about that recently scientists also identified that 90% of our human DNA actually have got microbial origin. And we are only 10% human. I think this is really astonishing. So we really have to respect this little microorganism which living on your skin, on your skull, inside of you. So when I talk to children, I always say, just think about it. Before you go into the toilet for the big thing, you are more bacterial than after. So make sure that you go to the toilet on a regular basis. Keep your human origin going, okay?
Do we get the microbiome from our parents?
Yes, actually, definitely. That's why the generation from generation link is so important. That's why the natural birth way is so important. That's why the breastfeeding is so important. And when that was forgotten and compromised little bit due to, again, the misunderstanding of the whole concept, we gave a start of many, you know, children with a compromised microbiome from the beginning.
Okay,
so let's continue. So my favorite microbiome. I just want to stress Once again, it's so important. The microbiome is affecting every system, every organ, every tissue, every type of cell. And that's something, if you, there is something going wrong inside of your body, that's the place that to address. And I think about 90-95% in our society have got compromised microbiome right now. Because again, due to lifestyle, the way we eat, the way we sleep, how much stress we experience, etc., etc. So now, once we understand a little bit where the problems can come and where the, you know, good stuff can come from, so how we can control situation, we definitely can say, and this has been shown and statistically proven, that 85% or even more of chronic diseases can be preventable. This is very, very powerful message, but what we also know, that's not only prevention, but actually diseases and conditions, chronic, including autism, can be treatable and reversible. And I'm really honestly, from this stage, tell you that. Because we learn that autism, for example, it's not just a brain disorder or a condition or neurodevelopmental condition. This is the whole body disorder, condition, which depends the way we live, the way we, you know, create our children and support their health. And that's why we need to dig into. And if you've got heart issues or liver or skin, that's just where your condition manifesting. This is the symptoms. We used to call the disease by symptoms, but this is not the right way. Now we're talking about functional approach, and we need to go and identify the core. And very often, environmental issues, the level of toxicity in your body, and the microbiome, that's where we need to start to look into it. And once we understand this is the whole body issue and start to deal with it, we start to see miracles. And I don't really afraid of this word, because when the body starts to heal itself from inside out, this is, I call, really real life miracle. And just to illustrate this little bit, I want to meet very quickly a young guy, Simon.
I love the way I've turned out. I love all the crazy things that have happened to me. Several things I'm really excited about. I'm very excited about studying some of the things in college, like history and media studies. I'm also thinking of doing graphic design. I would like to get married and have a family. Not right now. There's a few things I have to do first. I know that being autistic was part of my past, but I look at it as a true gift. I see that if I can do something so incredible as to reach out from an unreachable place, I can reach anywhere I want. It's beautiful.
This young guy who used to have autism, now looking forward to go to university, he's completely recovered. And I just love the way he expressed his feeling. And I have to admit, working with the children with autism, I see these things very, very often. For example, right now I'm working with a boy, 16 years old, David, who is developing beautifully. In 1.5 years of working together, he achieved so much. I visited his school, and it was so nice to talk to teachers who completely thrilled. They can't recognize the boy's development right now, and I'm sure in 2 years' time, he will be probably in the same position as Simon. This is remarkable, and if you want to know the more stories, please sign to my newsletters, because I share these positive stories all the time, and I also interview parents who've been with their children through this journey, and publish these interviews on my website and YouTube channel as well. So this is very encouraging news, and I'm sure with this example and other examples, I just try to get this message across to you that your health and the health of our future society in your hands, in these hands, and we can do much, much more than we think. So if we can do a lot, so why are we going to stop? So just the general little things. Please remember, even I know you've been thinking about what you eat and been trying to be healthy, but learn to understand your body. This is very important. Listen yourself, okay? So if you've got a headache, don't reach, paracetamol or something like that. This is a sign This is a symptom manifesting there is something going wrong in your body. Listen to your body. Maybe you just need a glass of water or a little bit of fresh air or deep breathing. Just don't push that pain. Pain try to tell you something, okay? Nutrition is a huge epigenetic factor, and hopefully you know now by that. So what does it really mean in real life? We need real food and diversity. If you do your daily sort of a calendar and writing down what you're eating, you might be surprised how repetitive your menu will be. Try to enrich it. Try to identify new ingredients. Don't be afraid to eat fats. This is already old-fashioned. So low-fat and non-fat products shouldn't exist. Bring smart fats in your life. Low sugar, I'm sure you know about this. And think about probiotic. This is a very big one. Remember about the microbiome we discussed. Bring back traditions. Cooking in the kitchen with your family, with your children, with your friends, with your you know, neighbors. This is the big thing. You know, this is no place to watch TV or play gadgets. This is a place to communicate, enjoy, taste, chew your food at least 25 times before you swallow them. This is very important, okay? Slow down and enjoy. Avoiding unnecessary toxicity is really, really big one, and this is not just about food, but also everything around our life, so including sort of the body care products. And it was a statistic published the other day somewhere, so that average woman using about 168 chemicals on her skin daily. Just think about it, okay? How many chemicals we put. Every product we're using, so the chemicals from the creams and things like that, the stuff we apply topically going to our skin in 27 seconds, 60% of it, okay? So we're just actually avoiding our gut barrier to protect us in putting these chemicals straight in our blood. Moderate and but regular exercise is very good to remember. So every day a little bit, much better than once a week. And my message to further parents, again, even you may not consider that at the moment, I know lots of us prepare financially, but it's not the only issue. We need to prepare ourselves for a new family, for a creation of healthier life, by mentally, by chemically, physically. And I just want you to take these five tips away with you that you really already can integrate this directly into your life. If you still not, stop eating and drinking processed products. And that can start very slowly from starting from obvious like a Coke and then going to coffee in the capsules, which is also not quite just a coffee. Go organic as possible. I know it's debatable, but trust me, organic, local, seasonal. This really worth investing your money because it's really worth it. Bring fermented food and drink into your life. Remember about these probiotics we just discussed, the microbiome. We need to feed this good bacteria. And traditionally, each culture got a whole list of fermented food and drinks. That's how our previous generation survived. And I'm sure you can find a way, and if you don't find, ask me afterwards, how to bring that to your life. Kombucha, kefir, sauerkraut, and etc., etc. Meanwhile, you can maybe think about probiotics in a capsule as a temporary solution. Find your way to manage your stress. We can't avoid stress in our life, but we need to find a way to manage it. And it's very individual for all of us. If I suggest you to go to meditate to everyone, maybe it doesn't work, but you will find a healthy way to get the stress away, because it's not about having a glass of wine or watching TV, maybe from time to time, yes, but this is not a regular stress management exercise. Don't forget about vitamin G, and G stands for grounding. Grounding is so important. Take away these shoes and just walk with bare feet in the garden. This is the biggest antioxidant exercise you ever can imagine. So this is very simple, but very powerful. And sleep. Sleep is so vital. It's so crucial. Even you've got millions of timelines and deadlines you have to face, just you need to sleep, because during the sleep, all your body actually detoxifying, all your organs taking away the debris, including the brain. Brain even shrinks during the night to make more space to all these sort of accumulating junk to get washed away. That's how important it is. Give your body a chance to restore. I could give you the lecture about whole points, but unfortunately we ran out of time. I really know that I'm already over. So what I would like you to take away with you, and I hope I demonstrated to you that survival is our choice, and I hope together we can think about creating a healthy start for the generation ahead. And if you've got any questions, reach me or people doing similar job like me. We're here to help. Thank you.